Good afternoon, class. This is Dr. Gasco, Edgar Gasco, and I would like to make a virtual lecture on our next topic, which is the urinary system. Okay, so I'll be talking about the kidneys, the ureters, the bladders, the urethra. So to begin with, this sort of review. This is the posterior abdominal wall. You have the structures that forms a posterior abdominal wall, and the structures that are found on the posterior abdominal wall are what we call the retroperitoneal structures. So you have here this picture which illustrate what are the so-called retroperitoneal structures. They are called retroperitoneal because only the anterior part of the organs are covered with the parietal peritoneum. So this is the parietal peritoneum. So posterior to that, the structures are called retroperitoneal. And we have mentioned already some of the retroperitoneal structures before, like the abdominal aorta, inferior vena cava, then the kidneys, suprarenal gland. For the intestines, you have the ascending colon, descending colon, the second, third, fourth part of the duodenum. So these are all so-called retroperitoneal structures. And I'm going to lecture on the kidneys. You have this picture here. You have the right and left kidneys, more or less the highlight of the both kidneys are found at the level of L1. And if you notice the picture, the right kidneys is a little bit lower than the left kidney, because in the right kidney you have in the upper part the bulk, the kidney, the liver, the bulky liver, which somewhat push the liver, the kidneys downward. So okay, but during inspiration, these two kidneys will descend due to the descent of the diaphragm, around 2.5 centimeters they will descend downward and then go back to its normal position during exhalation or expiration. Okay, so that's the kidneys. And you have here the renal pelvis, the ureters going down. Okay, so we'll take up next the parts of the kidneys. So this is the kidney and divided into the superior pole. This is related superiorly by the suprarenal glands. You have here this right and left suprarenal glands, which are found or related to the superior pole. There's the lateral border, anterior surface, inferior pole. And you have here the pelvis of the kidney located in the hilum. Yeah? So the indented part of the medial surface of the kidneys with the hilum, where you'll find the pelvis of the kidney as well as the blood vessels. Now, just a sort of a reminder with regards to the term pelvis. When you use the word pelvis, you have to qualify. You have renal, you should use the word renal pelvis or pelvis of the kidney. Or if you are referring to the bone, you should use the word bony pelvis, meaning it's the bone. So if you have the kidneys, pelvis of the kidney, you use the word renal pelvis or pelvis of the kidney, not just pelvis. So you not be confused whether it is the bony or the renal. Okay, so this is the section, sagittal section of the kidney. And we'll take up first the coverings. Now you have numerous coverings. Now the first is the fibrous capsule. Okay, the innermost covering is called the fibrous capsule. Sometimes it is also called the true capsule. true capsule, because there is a false capsule, which I will mention later on. So this is the fibrous capsule. After that, you have the perirenal fat. The perirenal fat. Okay? So the perirenal fat separates the kidney from the suprarenal gland. So we mentioned that above, you have on the superior pole, you have the suprarenal gland. Now this suprarenal gland is separated from the kidney by this perirenal fat. Okay, so after the perirenal fat, you have the renal fascia. Renal fascia. You have numerous names for this. You can use renal fascia. You can use perirenal fascia. Or the most common terms called Giroutas capsule. Giroutas capsule. So Giroutas capsule is the other name for renal or perirenal fascia. And it is sometimes considered as the false capsule, the false capsule. And it is derived from the transversalis fascia. Transversalis fascia. The last covering, which is quite bulky, is the pararenal fat. You can see here in this picture, this big bulk of fat which surrounds the kidney is called the pararenal fat. So these structures, you know, the fibrous capsule, fat, the perirenal, as well as the, especially the pararenal fat, is the one that provides support to the kidney, together with the intra-abdominal pressure, support of the kidney. Okay. Now, this is the sagittal section, showing to you the structures inside the parenchyma. We start with the hilum, the kidney. So you have here the renal pelvis, renal vessels, the renal vein, the renal artery, and the renal pelvis, which is found in the hilum. Okay. Now this proceed into the so-called renal sinus. This area here is called the renal sinus. Renal sinus. So, if you so the hilum is continued inward as an wide area called the renal sinus. Now, with regards to the orientation of these structures, you have the term vawa, meaning to say from antero, posterior. The first structure that you will see is the renal vein. Renal vein. You have here the term vein arteriorter. Okay, so the first structure you will see starting from the anterior is the renal vein. Okay, so the renal, this is the picture of the renal vein. You will notice that's the first structure that you will see, and on the left kidney, the left renal vein will cross the aorta anteriorly, the left renal vein. Okay, so another thing about the left renal vein, it receives tributaries, from the left suprarenal vein. The left suprarenal vein drains into the left renal vein, as well as the left ovarian or the left testicular vein, or the left gonadal vein. When you see gonads, it refers to the testicular or ovarian. So this left testicular or left ovarian vein drains into the left renal vein. So these are two tributaries that on the left renal vein. Now, after the renal vein, so the term is vawa, vein, artery, ureter, artery again. Okay, so after the renal vein, the two segmental arteries, two segmental arteries. Take note, that the renal artery, once inside the hilum of the kidney, it will divide into segmental arteries. No? So the first branch, group of branches of the renal artery are called segmental arteries. Usually there are 5 segmental arteries. No? So what you will see initially are 3, but later on it becomes 2 are added, so all in all you have 5 segmental arteries. So what you will see after the vein, you have two segmental arteries, Then after the two segmental arteries, you have the ureter. You have the ureter. Okay. Then after the ureter, you have another segmental artery. So those are the arrangement at the hilum of the kidney. Okay. So when you get inside in the renal sinus, you have the renal pelvis here, and this is formed by the union of the major calyx. Major calyces you have here. This is the major calyx, one major calyx, another major calyx. So you have two or three major calyces that unite with each other to form the renal pelvis. While the major calyx is formed by the union of minor calyces. So these are the minor calyces. Okay? And the minor calyx, or the minor calyces, are indented into the renal papilla. Okay? This is the renal papilla. And the function of this, of course, is to receive the urine, which drains from the collecting tubules found in the renal medulla. Okay, so the minor calyx receive urine into the major, then finally the pelvis into the ureter. And these are found in the renal sinus, which is part of the so-called renal medulla. So this area here is the renal medulla. Okay. Other structures found in the renal medulla are the so-called renal pyramids. So the renal pyramids. So these are the renal pyramids found in the renal medulla. And it is pyramidal in shape, as the name implies. The base are directed towards the renal cortex. And you have here the apex, from on which the minor calyx is indented inward. So, and what are the structures found in the so-called pyramid? You will see that grossly you have striations, because the renal pyramid contains the so-called straight collecting tubules. You have this illustration here. This is illustration here of the structures found in the renal pyramid. Okay, so this one is the renal pyramid, and these are the structures found inside. Primarily, the numerous straight collecting tubules. Now, these straight collecting tubules contains urine. And each collecting tubule opens into the renal papilla. So you can see here, you have numerous openings here in the renal papilla. Okay. Because of the numerous openings found, it looks like a crib reform. When you say crib reform, meaning it has numerous opening, just like the crib reform plate. Numerous opening. That's why the renal papilla is also called area cribrosa. That's the other term for the renal papilla, or the descriptive term of the renal papilla, because of the presence of the numerous openings. Now, these openings again are the openings of the straight collecting tubules. Now, aside from this collecting tubules, you can see part of the nephrons, especially the lobe of Henle, as well as the vasa rectae, the blood vessels, anastomosis between the arterioles and the veins. Okay, so these are the structures in the renal papilla here. Okay, now the location of the structural and functional unit of the kidney, functional unit is called the nephrons. Nephrons are found in the renal cortex. So this is the renal cortex here, and there are some of the part of the renal cortex which descends downward into the medulla, which we call the renal columns. Oh, the renal columns, part of the renal cortex found between renal pyramids, are called the renal columns. Okay, and you have the structural or the functional unit called the nephrons, found in the renal cortex. So a sort of a review, I'm sure you have already taken up kidney or the urinary system in probably in histology or in physiology. So I'll sort of review you what are the parts of the nephrons. Okay, we'll start with the so-called the tuft or TUFT, tuft of capillaries, which is called glomerulus. Okay, glomerulus. That is where the filtration of the blood occurs. The dialysate coming from the blood is called glomerular filtrate. Glomerular filtrate. You don't call it urine. Don't call it. It's called glomerular filtrate, found in the tuft of capillaries called the glomerulus. Okay. Then after the glomerulus, the next structure you have it here is the Bowman's capsule. This is the Bowman's capsule. Then after the Bowman's capsule, you have the proximal convoluted tubule. Proximal convoluted tubule. And then you have the lobe of Henle here. You have the descending limb. You have the ascending limb. Okay. And then after that, you have the distal convoluted tubule. Distal convoluted tubule. So what is the next structure after the distal convoluted tubule? It is now called the arcuate, collecting tubule. I don't know if you can see here. Arcuate, this one. Arcuate, collecting tubules. You have it here. This in one straight collecting tubules, you will have numerous arcuate. All of this here you can see. These are called arcuate, collecting tubules. Arcuate collecting tubules. This is the terminal continuation of the distal convoluted tubule. So when it's already in the collecting tubules, arcuate collecting tubule, as well as in the straight collecting tubule, the fluid inside is now called urine. You don't call it glomerular filtrate. It's now called urine. Okay. So that's it. You have numerous straight collecting tubules, opens in the area cavernosa, then it is being received by the minor calyx. Okay, so that's the how the urine is being formed. Now, next you have the blood supply, the arterial blood supply. We mentioned that the renal artery will divide into five segmental arteries. Then the segmental arteries will divide into lobar arteries. Okay, so the kidneys divide into lobes, which is not clear cut, but they are divided into lobes. So you have lobar arteries. After the lobar artery, the next branch is the interlobar. So you can see here, you have now the picture. So segment renal, segmental, lobar, interlobar. So what you will see now is interlobar, found between the pyramids. Interlobar artery. Now the interlobar artery will divide, terminate, and divide into arcuate artery, which is found at the base of the pyramid. So this is the arcuate artery. Okay, so and the arcuate artery will give rise to the interlobular artery. So interlobular artery is a branch of arcuate artery. So this is the one, this is the interlobular artery. Now, the interlobular artery will give rise to the so-called afferent arteriole. This one here, there is no label, but this is the afferent arteriole. Okay? Now, the afferent arteriole is the one that will give rise to the glomerulus. The tuff of capillaries. Tuff means T-U-F-T. The spelling is T-U-F-T. So this is the afferent arteriole, glomerulus, then continued going out from the glomerulus is the efferent arteriole. Efferent arteriole. So you have here now efferent arteriole. Okay, so the efferent arteriole will now anastomose with the venous side, with the venules, the venules. It's now going to the venous side. Okay, so if you're going to recapitulate, so you have renal artery, segmental artery, lobar artery, interlobar artery, arcuate artery, interlobular artery, afferent arteriole, glomerulus, efferent arteriole. So that is the sequence of the arterial branches. Okay, so next, I think we're through with this. This is the important relations, what is important are the anterior relations. Just take note the relations, in the right kidney as well as in the right left kidney. So in the right, you have the right suprarenal gland, you have the liver, you have the colon here, you have the small intestines and the duodenum. On the left side, you have left suprarenal gland, you have the stomach, the spleen, the pancreas, the colon and the small intestines. So those are the important anterior relations of the right and left kidneys. Now, you have here a picture of a kidney transplanted. Now, take note that the kidneys, embryologically, are developed in the pelvic cavity. Now, in the later stage of their development, the kidneys will ascend upward, and will be settled at the level of more or less the second lumbar vertebra. First, the hilum will be located more or less at the level of the first lumbar vertebra. Now, so from the pelvic cavity going up, it is opposite with the testes. You see, the testes are developed embryologically and on the posterior abdominal wall at the level of L1 again. But the testes will descend in the later stage of development. The testes will descend into the scrotum. So opposite ang course nila or pathway nila. Testes from above going down, kidney from below going up. Sometimes the kidney failed to ascend upward and you have an ectopic kidney or we call the pelvic kidney. You have other abnormalities, of course, like horseshoe-shaped kidney, polycystic kidney, but that would be discussed probably in surgery. So, okay. Now, we'll proceed to the ureter. Okay, dito na labit ka pwede. Kasi rin yan. Dito, dito na lang. Dito, here. So, okay, so you have here the renal pelvis, okay? Then they have the ureter going down. More or less, it is around 10 inches in length or 25 centimeters, just like the length of the esophagus. And it goes into the pelvic cavity and terminates in the urinary bladder, okay? And you have here an arrow which illustrate the site of physiological constriction. So this one, the first physiological constriction is here. This is the junction between the ureter and the pelvis. You know? So we call this junction here, you know, with arrow, ureteropelvic junction. Ureteropelvic junction. That is where the first physiological constriction occurs. Now, and the bony landmark is the transverse process of the first lumbar vertebra. The transverse process of the first lumbar vertebra. That is the bony landmark. The second physiological constriction is here, okay? As the common, this is the common iliac artery, bifurcates into external and internal iliac arteries. The ureter will cross anteriorly that site of bifurcation, and it will cause the second physiologic constriction. Okay, and the bony landmark is the sacroiliac joint. The bony landmark for the second physiologic constriction is the sacroiliac joint. Now, the third physiologic constriction here, as you have another third arrow, is as the ureter pierces the wall of the urinary bladder. As the ureter pierces the wall of the urinary bladder, it will cause another physiologic constriction. And the bony landmark for the third physiologic constriction is the ischial spine. Ischial spine. Okay. Now, what is the clinical significance of these physiologic constrictions? These are the usual site where renal stones are lodged. Renal stones are usually lodged in the physiologic constrictions of the ureter. Okay? Or sometimes that could be also site of malignancies, no? Like tumors can occur in the physiologic constriction. But the most common The important clinical aspect is that it is the usual site for the lodgement of the ureteral stones or renal stones. Okay, so now the blood supply in the upper part is supplied by the renal artery. Okay, this is the upper part. The middle part is supplied by the gonadal arteries. Gonadal. When you say gonadal, it could be the testicular or the ovarian artery. And the third part or the lower part, a branch coming from the superior vesical artery. Superior vesical artery. So those are the branches, the blood supply to the ureters. Okay, now the ureter, as it penetrates the urinary bladder, it has no valve. So what prevents the reflux of urine from the bladder to the ureter? It is the oblique penetration. The oblique penetration of the ureter into the muscular bladder wall causes a physiologic valve, prevents reflux of urine from the bladder into the ureter. But no anatomical valve. Okay. So now before we go further downward, we will take up these two. We have, these are the suprarenal glands, which are located in the superior pool, separated from the kidney by the perirenal fat. And you have the right suprarenal gland, which is somewhat pyramidal in shape, and the left suprarenal gland on the superior pool, which is somewhat crescentic in shape. Okay, now the suprarenal gland or adrenal glands divided into two. You have the adrenal cortex and the adrenal medulla. You know, the adrenal cortex, the importance of adrenal cortex is that it secretes hormones. You know? What are the hormones? You have the mineralocorticoids, the glucocorticoids, and some amount of sex hormones for the adrenal cortex. For the adrenal medulla, it secretes catecholamines, epinephrine and norepinephrine. The cells found in the adrenal medulla are neurosecretory cells. They are neurons, but they have the capability to secrete hormones. And these are, in fact, the adrenal medulla is considered as a large ganglion, sympathetic ganglion, the adrenal medulla. So that is the function. Sometimes you can have tumor in the adrenal medulla and it will cause malignant hypertension. Okay? So that's the function of the adrenal gland. The blood supply comes from three branches. One, the upper part of the superior, comes from the inferior phrenic. The second suprarenal artery comes from the aorta, direct branch from the aorta. And the inferior or the third suprarenal artery comes from the renal artery. So the arteries that gives branches to the suprarenal gland, you have inferior phrenic, abdominal aorta, and the renal artery. And the with regards to its venous drainage, you know, the suprarenal vein. Now the suprarenal vein is only one, and it is found at the hilum of the suprarenal gland, at the hilum. So the artery will enter in the convex. This is the convex. You have this. This is the inferior phrenic artery. So from it gives branches in the superior suprarenal on the convex side. Convex. So one from abdominal aorta, the third from renal artery on the convex. In the concave side or the hilum, you have only one suprarenal vein. There is only one suprarenal vein. Now on the right side, the right suprarenal vein drains directly into the inferior vena cava. But on the left side, the left suprarenal vein drains into the left renal vein. So there are two tributaries of the left renal vein. One, left suprarenal vein, and the other one, the left ovarian or the left testicular vein. Okay. So we now proceed to the urinary bladder. Okay, here. So this is the urinary bladder, and this is a muscular organ composed primarily of the muscles. You have the layers, you have the serosa or the upper part covering the serosa, But in the lower part, there is no peritoneal covering. Then you have a big muscular wall, which is composed of three layers. No? So they have three layers of muscles of the bladder. The muscles of the bladder are called the, we also call them detrusor muscles. We call them detrusor muscles. And then last, you have the mucosa. The mucosa. Now, the mucosa of the urinary bladder is thrown into folds. You know? It's thrown into folds, just like the stomach, and which we call the rogae, which we call the rogae. Okay, except a part, we'll discuss later on, a part where there is no, it is smooth. Okay, so first the bladder is found in the pelvic cavity, urinary bladder is found in the pelvic cavity. But in a newborn, sometimes it can be palpable above the pubic, the suprapubic area. You can palpate the urinary bladder in newborn, young children. But in the adult, it's not palpable. When the bladder is palpable in adult, it is a full bladder. It is a full bladder. Okay, so in fact, that is how you determine if a patient which says that he was not able to urinate or has difficulty of urination, you palpate the hypogastric area, and if you can feel the part of the bladder, it is full, it's tense, that it means that there is urinary obstruction. Okay, so normally it's not. When the bladder is palpable only, which is full. Okay, so it is pyramidal in shape, as you can see here. This is the apex of the urinary bladder, and this is the base, no, being a pyramid, or the posterior surface. So at the apex, you'll find a ligament. The ligament found here is called the median umbilical ligament. Median umbilical ligament, which you can appreciate in the parietal peritoneum of the anterior abdominal wall, the median umbilical ligament. Now this, the median umbilical ligament, is the remnant of the structure called urachus. Now you have here, I think I have a picture. Here, okay. Now, please take note. This is the embryonic development of the urinary bladder. So, this is the urinary bladder. Now, you have a structure that goes out from the apex urinary bladder, which is called allantois. This allantois will proceed into the umbilicus. When it is open, it now is called urachus. So, allantois becomes urachus. Now, this urachus is the site for the exit of urine. And during fetal development, okay, when the urine that is formed by the kidney is delivered into the placenta, because the fetus is not able to micturate or urinate, so urine that is formed will be transported into the placenta via the allantois, or the, in the older part, we can urachus. Now this urachus, when the fetus is already able to micturate, the urine coming from the bladder will be eliminated into the amniotic fluid by the micturation of the fetus. So this becomes vestigial, and the urachus will become fibrous. It has no longer its function. It becomes fibrous. And when the urachus become fibrous, it is now called median umbilical ligament. But there are congenital anomalies wherein the urachus will still have urine, and we call that condition as patent urachus. This is a congenital anomaly in which in a newborn, you can have secretions in the umbilical, in the umbilicus, and you have to examine, but because that secretions could be urine, and you have to entertain the possibility of a patent uracus. Okay? No. Okay, so we'll go back to this picture here. Now, okay, so this is another picture of the urinary bladder, which is pyramidal in shape. You have here the apex, and you have here peritoneum, which is actually the median, the continuation of the median umbilical ligament. Now, this is the superior bladder of the superior wall of the urinary bladder, and it is covered with peritoneum. Take note that the part of the urinary bladder that is covered by the peritoneum, parietal peritoneum, is just the superior surface. See here, superior surface, part of the posterior surface. So, but the inferior lateral, the bulk of the inferior lateral, and on the neck, there is no parietal peritoneum. This urinary bladder, when it's filled with urine, the shape from pyramid becomes ovoid. So it becomes ovoid. Okay, it rises up into the hypogastrium of the abdominal region, goes up, and when it goes up, it is now palpable. And take note of the position of the peritoneum. The peritoneum will be peeled off and also ascends upward like this. Okay, ascends upward. And what is the clinical significance of that? If you have a distended bladder in which the person cannot urinate because there is obstruction in the urethra, you can perform suprapubic cystostomy. This is the body of the pubis. You can perform suprapubic cystostomy, meaning to say you can put a needle, a large bore needle here, or a tube, go this way, entering the bladder wall without penetrating the peritoneum. Because as you can see here, the peritoneum also goes up. It peeled off from the wall and goes up. So you can perform suprapubic cystostomy without entering the intraperitoneal cavity, without piercing the peritoneum. Okay? So that is the significance of knowing the fact that the peritoneum also goes up as the bladder is filled with urine. Now this is the anterior surface of the bladder. At the region of the neck, this is the neck here, you'll have a ligament, which we call the pubo, this pubic from the bone, pubic puboprostatic ligament. So there is this ligament found in the surface there. Cavity here, which we call, this cavity here is called the space of Ricius. We call this space of Ricius. You can read the word Ricius here when you start reading your book. Space, or some will call it cave of Ricius or space of Ricius here. The space between the bladder and the body of the pubis. And there is a ligament here called the puboprostatic ligament. Take note that the ligament is anchored only at the region of the neck, puboprostatic, because the prostate gland is used here. In the female, you call this a pubovesical because there is no prostate gland. So because the ligament is located here below, so it cannot alter or it cannot disturb the ascent of the superior wall of the bladder. Okay, so that's the important structure in the anterior surface. Now, this is the inferior lateral surface. And this is the base or the posterior surface. And you have here, the, this the neck, we'll find the urethra. So at the base or posterior surface, this is what you will see. This is what you will see here. This is the posterior surface or the base of the urinary bladder. And what are the important structures you will see? Of course, you have here the seminal vesicle. You have the lobulated seminal vesicle. You have another lecture of that when you take up the reproductive, the male reproductive organs. That will be, there is a separate lecture for that. So this is the right and left seminal vesicles. Now these seminal vesicles, take note, it's not for the storage of the sperm cells, but the secretes fluid for the nutritional need of the sperm cells. So it secretes secretions, which is used to for the nutrition of the sperm cells. Okay, and the two seminal vesicles is separated from each other by the so-called vas deferens. This is the vas deferens. Now, the vas deferens is one of the content of the spermatic cord, no? It's one of the content that passes by the spermatic cord. It passes through the inguinal canal and then descend downward. Now, when it goes in the posterior surface of the bladder, it becomes dilated. So when it's now called ampulla. Oh, this is called the ampulla of the vas deferens. So you have two ampulla of the vas deferens, which separates the two seminal vesicles. So this will proceed into the prostate gland. Okay, prostate gland. So, and this is the neck of the urinary bladder that rested on the prostate gland. So this is the prostate gland, and we'll discuss later on. You have another lecture for the so-called prostate gland, because the seminal vesicle as well as prostate gland, they belongs to the so-called internal genitalia of the male reproductive organs. Okay, so we'll proceed to the urinary bladder. This is what you will see inside the urinary bladder. You have here the mucosa, and this thrown to folds called the urogate. But there is a portion near the region of the urethral orifice, which is called the trigone. This is called the smooth surface trigone. The smooth surface of the mucosa of the urinary bladder is called trigone. It's called trigone because it is triangular in shape. Okay, it is the mucosa is smooth because it is firmly adherent to the underlying muscle fibers, muscular layer. They are firmly adherent to the underlying muscular layer, so they are smooth. While the rest, these are called rogae. Okay, this rogae will disappear when it's filled with urine, but it will reappear once it's empty. So this is the small surface called trigone. So you have three angles here. This is the lower, and you have two superolateral. Now this superolateral are called the ureteric orifice. Meaning to say, it is the site where the ureter will enter the bladder. So, and between the two ureteric orifices, you have a ridge, which is called interureteric ridge, or crest rather. It's called crest, interureteric crest. Okay. Now, this is smooth. Now, the left ureter, as mentioned before, you have no anatomical bulbs, but what prevents the reflux of the urine is the oblique penetration of the ureter into the bladder wall that prevents. Okay. Okay, so now on the inferior angle, you'll find the no, before we go into that, you have here in the inferior angle you have here the opening called urethral orifice. Urethral orifice. Take note, you have to qualify because you have two orifices. You have internal and external. This one is the internal urethral orifice. Okay? Internal urethral orifice or meatus. But they usually use the word orifice. Internal. Why? Because you have external. Where can you find external? In the glans penis. We call the external urethral orifice, but more commonly called external urethral meatus. So you have to qualify here, you have to use the word internal urethral orifice. Okay? It is also called vesical orifice. Vesical. Vesico refers to the bladder. So it's called vesical orifice or internal urethral orifice. And this orifice provided by a circular smooth muscles which provide a sphincter. So the internal urethral orifice is provided by internal urethral sphincter. Now this internal urethral sphincter is involuntary. Involuntary, meaning to say, once the bladder is filled with urine, the internal urethral sphincter automatically relax. And this relaxation of the internal urethral sphincter will send an impulse into the brain and you will have the sense, the urge of micturition. Okay, so this one is internal. This is located at the neck and this rested on the prostate gland. So, first opening, internal urethral orifice, then the next destination is in the prostate gland. No? That's the urethra of the prostate gland. It's called the prostatic urethra. So you have here the prostate gland, which is a part of the male genitalia. And just like here, it secretes a fluid. The fluid secreted by the prostate gland is alkaline, and primary function is to counteract the acidity in the vaginal mucosa, because the sperm cell in acidic medium will die. So prostate gland secretes alkaline secretions to neutralize the vaginal acidity, so the sperm cells will not die. Okay, so this is the prostate gland. Then after the prostatic urethra is the membranous urethra. Okay, so now the blood supply to the urinary bladder is from the superior and inferior vesical arteries, a branch of the internal iliac artery. You have here, I think we will use this word, nervous control of the bladder. Now, the nervous control of the bladder is from the sympathetic and the parasympathetic, okay? Now, the sympathetic usually comes from L1 and L2, and it joins the plexus, the inferior hypogastric plexus, the sympathetic. The parasympathetic come from S2, S3, S4. S2, S3, S4. Which is called the pelvic splanchnic nerve. Pelvic splanchnic nerve. Now, the sensations from the whole bladder can go from sympathetic L1, L2 or via the parasympathetic S2, S3, S4. Sympathetic sensory. Sensory sensations, no? Sensations, sensory sensations. Or when the bladder is filled with the urine, when there is a relaxation of the sphincter, it sends an impulse via sympathetic L1, L2, or via parasympathetic S2, S3, S4. Okay, so what is the effect of the sympathetic? The sympathetic is prevent contraction of the bladder wall, and it also cause the constriction of the sphincter, prevent relaxation of the sphincter. What is the effect of the parasympathetic? It's the opposite, meaning to say it causes contraction of the detrusor muscle. Parasympathetic effect, contraction of the detrusor muscle, relaxation of the internal urethral sphincter. Internal urethral sphincter. Okay, so that is for the sympathetic, the nervous supply. Now, okay, here. Now this is your picture now of the prostate gland. So I mentioned before, the prostate gland secretes the alkaline fluid, and it has actually divided into five lobes. You have here the lobes here. You have the anterior lobe. You have anterior lobe. You have two lateral lobes, two right and left lateral lobes. Then you have one posterior lobe, and you have one median lobe. Median lobe, okay? Now this median lobe here is the one that projects upward to form the uvula vesicae. I think I mentioned here. Just now. Ayan, uvula vesicae. Okay, here. This is the internal, this is urethral orifice. This is a slight elevation posterior to it. This slight elevation is called uvula vesicae. And this elevation is caused by the median lobe. This is the median lobe. And clinically, this median lobe is the most common lobe that is involved in benign prostatic hypertrophy. Benign prostatic hypertrophy usually occurs in the median lobe. And when this becomes enlarged, very large, it can cause obstruction of flow of urine. And that is what happens here. Okay, so you have here an enlarged median lobe, the prostate. So this is a case of benign prostatic hypertrophy. And what happens? You have a person will have a difficulty of urination, initiating urination. So what comes out? A small amount of urine because of this obstruction. And when that happens after urination, there is another urge of micturition or urination because some of the fluid will stagnate at the posterior part. So this urine here in the posterior part will cause again an urge of urination. But once it urinates, it has difficulty and only small dribbling of urine. So it is the median lobe that causes the benign culprit of the benign prostatic hypertrophy. Okay, and this is the prostatic urethra. Okay, and you have here the sides of the so-called levator ani. Now take note, this levator ani, this is called the pelvic diaphragm. Okay, now this levator ani is the demarcating structure between the pelvic organs or the pelvic cavity and the perineum. So above levator ani is the pelvic region. Below levator ani is perineum. So this area here, where you have urogenital diaphragm, is already part of perineum. So take note, levator ani is the one that serves as the boundary between the pelvic and perineum. Okay, so you have here the prostate gland, which is a fibromuscular organ, meaning to say it has fibers coming from the pelvic pelvic fascia. You have fibrous in muscular. You have muscles here. The muscles actually comes from the urinary bladder, which descends downward, muscular. And then glandular. So it is fibro. It has fibers. muscular, which has muscles coming from the bladder, and glandular, fibromuscular glandular organ. So you have all the glands here. The glands here are called the prostatic acini. Prostatic acini. Okay, so you have here the prostatic urethra. It is the most dilatable part of the urethra. Now, the urethra in the male is divided into three. One, prostatic. Two, membranous. Three, penile urethra, or the penis. The penile urethra. Okay? So, this is the prostatic urethra here, the most dilatable. And you have here elevation at the center, which is we call the urethral crest. There is a slight elevation. Okay, this slight elevation here called the urethral crest, slight elevation. At the sides are called the sinus here, yeah? Prostatic sinus here. And in the prostatic sinus, that is the site for the drainage of the pancreatic acini. Meaning prostatic acini. The prostatic acinal glandular glands, or the glands, secretes or deposits its secretions in prostatic sinus. So this is the prostatic sinus, the sides here. So you can see here numerous opening prostatic sinus, numerous openings here at the sides. So that, those are the openings of the prostatic sinus. So at the center you have an elevation called urethral crest, but there is at the middle, there is a so-called prostatic, slight depression, prostatic utricle, prostatic utricle. Now, this prostatic utricle is the homologue for the uterus, the homologue for the uterus. So, you have homologies, meaning to say, for the labia majora, the homologue is the scrotum. Okay, for the penis, the homologue is the clitoris. Or the what we call the spermatic cord, the homologue is the round ligament of the uterus. For the utricle, the homologue in the female is the uterus. For the Bartholin's gland, the homologue in the female is the Cowper's gland. So on your reading, you take note of the homologies, meaning what is the counterpart for this gland organ in the male and in the female. Okay, so this is the most dilatable, and you have here another picture, the urethra. So the prostate gland is being, there are two tubular structures that will pierce the urethra. That is the prostate gland, one is the prostatic urethra, and the other one is the ejaculatory duct. This is called ejaculatory duct or common ejaculatory duct. And this is the passage for this sperm cells from the ampulla of the vas deferens and the fluid coming from seminal vesicle. So the seminal vesicle and the vas deferens has a common ejaculatory duct, which bisects the prostate gland. Okay, and that common ejaculatory duct divides the gland into a median lobe here and a posterior lobe here. Okay, so secretions coming seminal vesicle, secretions coming from the prostate gland plus the sperm cells, all of them constitute the term semen. The semen are composed of those substances mentioned. Okay, so this is the next part of the male urethra is the membranous urethra. This is the shortest and less dilatable. The shortest and less dilatable is the membranous urethra. And it is found in the urogenital diaphragm. This area is called the urogenital diaphragm. Okay? The urogenital diaphragm is found, is part already of perineum. It's part already perineum. And this urogenital diaphragm contains muscles, contains the copper glands, contains fibers, blood vessels, okay? And the membranous urethra here are provided with circular muscles coming from the transverse perineal muscles. And this sphincter, the sphincter in the membranous urethra are voluntary sphincter. We call the external urethral sphincter. So external urethral sphincter is voluntary, composed of skeletal or striated muscle, while the internal urethral sphincter is involuntary, composed of smooth muscle coming from the detrusor or the muscles of the bladder. So this is involuntary, this one is voluntary, under control of the person through the pelvic splanchnic nerve, or through the pudendal nerve. Okay? Pudendal nerve. Do not be confused with the pudendal nerve and pelvic splanchnic nerve. Pelvic splanchnic nerve comes from S2, S3, S4, and that is parasympathetic. Pudendal nerve comes also from S2, S3, S4, but not parasympathetic, not autonomic, but it is a somatic nerve. A somatic nerve that supplies striated or skeletal muscle under the control of the person. So, once there is an urge of micturition, the internal urethral sphincter opens. Now urine goes down. It sends more impulse towards the brain that you are about to urinate, but you can hold the urine through your external urethral sphincter, which is voluntary. You can control the flow of urine going out. So this is the membranous urethra. So after the membranous urethra is the penile urethra, which is found in corpus spongiosum. Okay, so we'll have another lecture on regards to the penis. Now, with regards to the exit or the urine is into the external urethral meatus. External urethral meatus. And take note of all the passages of the urethra. The narrowest part is opening of the external urethral meatus. Okay? So, if you perform catheterization, once the catheter passes through the external urethral meatus, there is no reason why it won't go up to the bladder. Because the external urethral meatus is the narrowest part of the entire urethra. Okay? So, I think one more. So, that is all for this afternoon. You'll have another lecture next week, probably, mailed in Italia. By the way, before I forget, there will be no virtual laboratory. It's quite difficult to deal with very dry and quite confusing appearance of the cadaver. So we'll have a successive laboratory sessions once you'll have, it is already possible now, face-to-face. But when we do have face-to-face, it will be limited. You'll be divided to groups, and you will go inside the laboratory by groups, not the whole class. Okay, so that is all for this afternoon, and thank you for listening.